Hello and welcome to another episode and new season of Princeton Tonight. It's been a long summer and we're thrilled to be back, and we're still making stupid videos that we hope you're going to enjoy. I'm Cam, I'm the showrunner.
I'm Emily, I'm executive producer.
I'm Seb, I'm creative director.
And we can't wait to get to know you all better and better as the months go by. True. Now, you may have noticed we're wearing a series of fetching caps. Here to explain why we're wearing these caps is, may I remind you, the only US citizen among the three of us, Emily Shemrai.
Princeton has this initiative going on called Vote 100 that's trying to get 100% of the student body registered to vote and voting in the upcoming primary election. So send in your ballots, although the deadline was yesterday. Vote in the next election!
Nice.
Yes.
Well, now in the name of balance, I feel that I should take the time to say that I don't agree with the concept of democracy.
You promised you wouldn't go down this route.
I don't believe in the concept
you
of democracy.
You promised!
I don't believe in democracy, at least I don't believe in the modern view of democracy, which has been entirely savaged from its original intention. I believe that we should go back to the way democracy was originally intended, the way that they came up with it in ancient Athens, whereby we don't vote for who leads us, we do it by lottery. We do a random lottery of all the citizens in the country, and if you get picked, you rule for the next 4 years. I think it would lead to many, many fewer arguments, and ultimately, a bit of fun. So without any more political perverseness from Emily, we are going to throw it over to our very first video of the new season of Princeton Tonight, and it comes to us from our very own Shalaka. She's been a member of the team for some time, and we love her dearly. In this video, she decided to recreate some of her favourite vines. You remember Vine? That beautiful platform that we all love and was killed before its time, for no good reason, mercilessly. Well, she's done some of those. Please enjoy.
How much money do you have?
69 cents. Oh, you know what that means. I don't have enough money for chicken nuggets.
Wait, oh yes, wait a minute, Mr. Postman.
Female Ghostbusters, the feminists are taking over. I'm an adult virgin.
I don't get no sleep because of y'all. Y'all gonna get no sleep because of me. I don't get no sleep because of y'all. Y'all gonna.
And they were roommates.
My God, they were roommates.
Jared, can you please read number 23 for the class? No, I cannot.
Hey, what up? I'm Jared, I'm 19, and I never fucking learned how to read.
You know what? I'm about to say it.
Do it!
I don't care that you broke your elbow.
Look at all those chickens.
Yeah, I sure hope it does.
Why?
Why?
smell like beef. I smell like beef. I smell like beef. I smell like beef.
What the fuck is up, Kyle? No, what did you say? What the fuck, dude? Step the fuck up, Kyle.
I think I know more about American Girl dolls than you do, genius.
Over the past summer, I know.
So, over this past summer, two of our most valued team members here at Princeton Tonight, Jonathan Salama and the infamous Naomi Han, along with the Princeton Conservation Society, went to the American Prairie Reserve in northeastern Montana in order to document their ambitious goal of rewilding 3 million acres of public and private land, which has a massive implication on the native tribes of the area. Without further ado, the Princeton Conservation Society proudly presents Where the Buffalo Roam, Restoring the American Serengeti.
My name is Allison Fox, and I am the CEO of American Prairie Reserve. I joined American Prairie Reserve 10 years ago after I graduated from business school, and I had spent a summer in Glacier National Park and had a great appreciation for the big open spaces of the West and of Montana and of public lands. And so when the opportunity to join American Prairie Reserve arose, I jumped at it. American Prairie Reserve exists to do one thing, and that is to build a vast grassland park here in northeastern Montana. When we established our national park system in 1872 with Yellowstone, we went on to protect a number of our iconic landscapes, but we never protected a large swath of the grasslands. And temperate grasslands worldwide are the least protected terrestrial biome. So here in the 21st century, we have the opportunity to create a 3.5 million acre wildlife reserve with all of the flora and fauna and natural systems and processes that were once here back, and a place that the public can enjoy as well.
A lot of people think of Yellowstone as, you know, the flagship national park. Yellowstone, for most of the species inside it, isn't actually the native habitat. Yellowstone's a more mountainous, rocky type landscape, and actually the only reason those species are popular in that area is because it's one of the last protected areas. It's sort of their last refuge. They were driven back from all the other areas. Grizzly bears, wolves, elk, and bison, those are all plains animals.
American Prairie Reserve, once complete, will be home to almost all the species that call Yellowstone home too. And it's a grassland park, which means that it will have a much higher carrying capacity as compared to Yellowstone's terrain.
My name is Danny Kinka, and I am the Wildlife Restoration Manager at American Prairie Reserve. My job is to take the land that we're acquiring as American Prairie Reserve and fill it up with animals at its simplest level. How we go about doing that is different for different species and different contexts, but The primary goal is to create the reserve, this large wildlife reserve, and then of course the next goal is to fill it with wildlife, everything from bison to wolves to black-footed ferrets and prairie dogs. The project is 1.5 times the size of Yellowstone National Park. We need that much space to have enough space for bison to roam, and not just a small herd of 150 animals that's a token, that's a conservation herd, but a large enough herd that can migrate through and graze the grasslands in ways that actually have ecological impacts, that can maintain variable grass heights, heterogeneous grass heights throughout the prairie, so that we can create habitat for multiple different bird species that require on long grasses and short grasses and no grasses at all. Prairie dog towns that can stretch from one horizon to the other, that can support things like black-footed ferrets, one of the most imperiled mammals on the continent. Grasslands as an ecosystem are incredibly, incredibly imperiled across the planet. For whatever reason, they were overlooked 150 years ago when we were setting up the park system in this country and when other countries were doing conservation efforts for land preservation as well. This place has been used and traversed and loved by people for thousands and thousands of years. And to a large extent, probably co-evolved with the presence of people, native peoples, for thousands and thousands of years. We keep that in mind as we do wildlife restoration, that this is a place that, even though it looks very, very empty, is a place that people have been for quite some time.
We work primarily with the two tribes on Fort Belknap, the Ani and the Dakota tribes. And we've really been getting to know one another as neighbors over about the last decade. And so we support one another's events. Every time we have a bison release here on American Prairie Reserve, when we're bringing in new bison, we have members of the tribes come down and do a blessing ceremony and welcome these bison back to their ancestral homelands.
My proper name, as my great-grandma said it was, Wa'akianath, horse capture. But my modern-day name is George Paul Horse Capture Jr. I am the son of Spotted Otter, who is the son of White Rabbit, who is the son of Big Fox, who is the son of horse capture. I'm Aninin, nowadays known as Grovant, but I'm a white clay man. That's who I am. The history of present day Fort Belknap, like all Indians, not a good deal. Fort Belknap, we were forced here.
When we came to this continent and started settling the continent, there was probably about 30 million bison, and we thought it was an endless supply. We felt that we could harvest the animal and they'd never run out of bison. Following the Civil War, people started really settling up the plains, and they were rounding up the Indians or putting them onto reservations. They knew the bison was their food source, and they, in order to subjugate the Indians, they killed more bison. And it finally ended up, we wanted the land for grazing and for farming, and people didn't seem to really care.
Fort Belknap is a part of a much larger tract of land, which is called the 1855 Treaty. That was with us and the Blackfeet and the United States government, but reduced, you know, all the time. And the United States government, particularly in those days, and some of the mentality I know is still there, manifest destiny. The end justifies the means. Fort Belknap is just a very small part of us nomads, us Grovants, home range. And our home range is coast to coast and pole to pole. It's really hard for the outside to wrap their mind around what the buffalo mean to us. We had such a close relationship back when they was trying to civilize us, turn us into Christians, turn us into taxpayers, trying to get us just to change everything who we are. And if you think about it, very few races, other than the Indians, went from their language, their ceremonies, all this stuff, to where we are today in such a short period of time. Phil Sheridan, Civil War guy, he went before the president at the time, the president of the United States at the time, and the only way we're gonna deal with this Indian problem, get him to sit down on reservations or in those days it was territories, you hear the word Indian territory and stuff like that, is we have to get rid of the buffalo.
With the disappearance of the buffalo, a religious movement known as the Ghost Dance spread throughout the tribes of the Western Great Plains. It was believed that this prayer could bring back the buffalo.
That idea of the Ghost Dance, they were trying to dance back the buffalo. It was trying to dance back their ways.
The Ghost Dance movement was seen as an act of rebellion by Washington. In the winter of 1890, it came to a head at Wounded Knee. There, the U.S. Army opened fire and killed hundreds of unarmed Lakotas performing the dance.
Massacred. Massacred men, women, and children unarmed during a ceremony. That would be like going into a church or a synagogue or something and killing a person just for being who they are.
With all hope of bringing the bison back to the Great Plains gone, it was much easier to force tribes like the Ani and the Nakota onto reservations like Fort Belknap, which is located just north of the American Prairie Reserve.
In one sense, they had to come to the brink of extinction because they wanted to, for a better term, make us civilized. And it just really set things off kilter for our world. There are scars that those things leave.
This grassland here in northeastern Montana was identified as one of the best regions to try and preserve one of the last vestiges of that true virgin prairie ecosystem and restore it to look something like the American Serengeti that it was as few as 150 years ago, when you would have large herds of bison roaming out here, as well as elk and deer and their corresponding predators following through them through open grassland, just as Lewis and Clark saw it when they came through here and as the Native Americans knew it for thousands and thousands of years before white Europeans showed up on this continent. Bison and our prairie dogs assume that role of ecosystem architect. The bison, because of the way they graze, provide heterogeneous landscape in terms of grass height, that's those multiple different types of grass being utilized by multiple different species. Some birds will like tall grass, some like short grass, some like no grass, you name it. The bison manage that habitat, so to speak, for them, and the prairie dogs kind of do the same thing. There's a kind of a romantic notion when folks think of certain parts of Africa, the grasslands of Africa. You imagine a big, open, extensive landscape, giraffes and zebras and lions and all these species that are out there moving as big herds, big giant mammals out there on the landscape. And that's tragic because not that long ago, very, very recently in the grand scheme of things, just a couple hundred years ago, these grasslands would have been filled with North America's own version of those large mammals, these Pleistocene remnants and these large charismatic mammals that would graze in the same abundances and not the same species, but functionally similar ways as the species that we think of as so iconic on those African grasslands. Bison are important to creating the habitat, restoring it to the way it looked, for all of the species that call this place home, whether they're here now or just finding their way out here.
Well, there's certainly some controversy around this project because what we're aiming to create is a wildlife reserve, and this land has been used for the last 100 years as for cattle ranching primarily. You know, we're buying the land for when it comes for sale on the open market, just like anyone else would. And so I think that ability to do what we want on our own lands and have our own vision for our own lands is respected by a lot of our neighbors. We also recognize that we are going to be surrounded by cattle ranching even when our final wildlife reserve vision is complete.
We actually saw a lot of opposition to the prairie reserve around it, just from neighboring ranches. There was one billboard that said, "Don't buffalo me," and it was a protest of the reserves buying up land. And a lot of that hostility is because the ranchers think that the prairie reserve, by buying up ranch land, is eliminating the rancher lifestyle from the West. And I think they're especially hostile because a lot of the prairie reserve's money comes from wealthy donors.
They remove all of these miles and miles of fences that surround the ranches and keep the cattle in. And if they want to have a contiguous landscape for wildlife, they have to remove all the fences. So the land that the Prairie Reserve buys is going to be rewilded, never to be used for ranching again.
The American prairie, they're unique in a way. Come and visit. We're not going to kick you off. We're not going to, you know, we're going to welcome you. We'll make you a sandwich. We'll invite you to some of the, you know, these doings that, you know, are going on and stuff. We'll help you with your tourism. Some of you farmers and ranchers, think about it. If that's going to be the biggest game reserve in North America, do you realize some of these farmers and ranchers, the entrepreneur opportunities that will arise out of that?
Anytime you try to do something new on the landscape, I think it's only reasonable that certain people would have their hesitations about it. We think that we can do this in a way and still be good neighbors, invigorate the economy of this area, bring lots and lots of tourism revenue, maintain some of the traditional uses of this landscape, not lock it up. The whole idea of this place is to keep it open to people. And we do what we can to be good neighbors.
I've had incredible experiences in every season out here. I think one of my favorite winter experiences I was out here on a beautiful, beautiful February day. Prairie was covered with snow, it was bright blue skies, and we saw a herd of probably 600 to 800 pronghorn all moving in a group, migrating south, stretched out over a mile. And those are something that, you know, you hear only the old timers see. And so I feel really incredibly fortunate to see that. And as the pronghorn population rebounds here, we can get those kinds of sightings back.
Our bison got cameras, critter cams, that they wore around their necks, which allowed us to kind of see the world through the eyes of a bison. And those collars fell off after 2 weeks. They were programmed to fall off, and it fell to me to go find them. It was really, really snowy out here this winter, so kind of tough to get around and seemed too far to ski. And so I got a snowmobile, and I took off over the hill trying to chase this beeping collar signal to try and go find it. And so I came over on the snow machine, and they heard me. The snow machines are loud. And so they heard me before I came. And when I got up on the ridge, I got to see 15 to 20 bison running full tilt through 3 to 4 feet of snow right across the horizon. Giant, magnificent, powerful animal just plowing through all of this snow like it was powder, like it was baking soda. It just cruising right against this pale blue winter sky. And I killed the engine right away, and I just sat there and I watched it. And you couldn't see any fences, you couldn't see any people, you could see miles and miles to the horizon, and all I could see was snow and snow and snow and blue sky, and these bison running across the landscape. And I was like, that's why I'm here. That's I think why we're all here.
American Prairie invited some of our kids and myself down. They were releasing young buffalo to BLM, Bureau of Land Management land. And they opened the gate. The Indians were not allowed to even think about releasing buffalo there. But when they opened that gate to that BLM land, that was them ghost dancers' prayers coming true. Sometimes prayers take a long time, long time. Our kids got to witness that.
Should
put that one on too.
Over my actual mistake.
Yeah.
Okay. Really,
oh. Mm. There you go. Oh, don't answer.
Mm-hmm. How's it look?
Oh, Sam, take a selfie with me.
Now, we aren't the only video production team on campus. There are other student groups making their own content, not quite related to the stuff that we do. Not that I know what it is that we do, but apparently they make something different to that. Up next, we're going to show one such group. They're our good friends at 1080 Princeton. They make video journalism videos and short films based on different human interest stories around campus. We're all great fans of their work, and so we wanted to show them on the show. This isn't the last that you're going to see of them, because we are big fans and we do hope to feature a bit more of the great work that they do on the show. So up next, enjoy the first ever 1080 Princeton segment on Princeton Tonight.
I am FLY, so FLY stands for First and Low Income. Last year and this year, one of the groups on campus, Hidden Minority Council, put on FLY is FLY Week. The whole purpose of the week is to like bring awareness and bring more attention to narratives of first and low income students and like talk about class, because it makes everybody uncomfortable.
So I think a lot of times at highly selective colleges and universities, we have a whole kind of hidden curriculum. When students get to campus, oftentimes we say, well, you should be applying for fellowships. How do you even know what a fellowship is, right? Unless you've heard that term before, unless somebody has taught to you about, you know, what that opportunity would look like and how to go about getting one of those fellowships, right? And so one of the main goals for an office like ours, an Office of Access and Inclusion, is to really actually think about what it means for students to be able to equitably access the opportunities available to them at Princeton.
Programs like FSI, Freshman Scholars Institute, exist to ease that transition. So Princeton's FSI program happens for 6 to 8 weeks over the summer between a student's senior year and freshman year. And it is specifically designed for first-generation low-income students to experience taking 2 Princeton courses for credit, as well as experiencing like extracurricular options.
That was kind of a gateway into like the rigor of Princeton.
So over the past decade or so, we've undergone a kind of real shift in terms of the demographics of our students, particularly in terms of socioeconomic diversities. We have a no loan policy, and so that's a financial aid policy that really makes it possible for students from all backgrounds to access a Princeton education.
Back in 2005, only 7% of our students were eligible for a Pell Grant, which is sort of the government's benchmark, sort of flagship grant program, primarily for low and middle income families. With the incoming class of 2021, the most recent class that came here, that percentage increased to 22%.
And that doesn't even account for students, other first-gen low-income students who may not qualify for the Pell Grant, but still identify and have had the lived experience of being first-gen and low-income.
Coming into a very scary institution full of people that come from a place very different from you is eased when you have a solid group of like 50 to 70 students that you know on campus have that same identity as you. Because Princeton does have like statistically a lot of first generation low income students, but they don't walk around with signs saying, hello, I'm Fly, you can talk to me.
It builds a really awesome community for me of other students who come from similar backgrounds that I may not have met otherwise. So it was a really great community building time.
It's nice to know other people from like the same socioeconomic status that they exist here, because sometimes it feels like they don't. It seems like some or a lot of people don't have the same sensitivity for socioeconomic status. Like, I don't know, like some people grow up and don't have to see that or like realize that people think about that very often.
I think that the greatest problem is that so many students don't think about class here, and because of that, it becomes something that seems so far away or seems so foreign to them.
I just met someone, this was back in freshman year, but I just met someone, so I didn't really know them that well. We're still just acquaintances. We were having a conversation and they didn't really know much about my background. They were like, oh yeah, like I wish I was like low income, or I wish I was first gen, because that would have made like for a great essay, or it would have like made it so much easier for me to get in. And that was really difficult to handle because I come from that background, first of all, and it was really insulting to hear that like someone was commodifying my struggles, I guess. I know that he didn't like have bad intentions like in saying that. I know he wasn't trying to make me feel bad or trying to put down like the low-income community, but I think that definitely reflects the privilege that that person had and so many others at Princeton have, and I guess they don't really know how to handle that.
The differences and like the disparity between different like socioeconomic backgrounds on campus becomes super apparent super fast during vacations of school, because the people who come from backgrounds that allow them to do it go to fun places like Florida and like the Caribbean, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Whereas students who come from a more restricting financial situation usually stay on campus.
Just like when your friends want to go out to eat on Nassau, and that's really not something that's in my budget.
It kind of feels weird to say no to that, like 100% of the time whenever they would go. Like, it's really tough for Fly athletes. I have a lot of respect for when those two groups overlap with each other, because that's tough.
We can kind of create, as administrators on campus, a lot of different programs like FSI and SIFP that really help students, you know, transition and to feel empowered to be here and take advantage of opportunities. We can do all of that, but the cultural change takes more engagement of students who don't necessarily belong to the Fly community, but want to be allies to that community, to really take this on as something that they want to pursue on campus.
If someone wanted to be an ally to the Fly community, I would say the first step is recognizing that a middle or upper middle or higher socioeconomic status is the invisible norm.
I think that for the most part, Princeton does a pretty good job of accommodating its low-income and first-gen students, so I'm really appreciative of that.
We have faculty specifically dedicated to the purpose of advocating for these students. And while that's not always successful, it is important to recognize that they're there.
Things like the Garden Theater movies that they have on the weekends that are free to all the students, I mean, that's really great because everyone can go regardless of their economic background. But I do think that the social life and that, you know, the eating club scene, I think that's very intertwined in wealth and money matters.
So I recently joined Quad, and Quad actually has a large number of Fly community members in it, including a lot of the officers. However, that doesn't mean that financially it's convenient.
It costs a total of $18,300 to be in Quadrangle, $18,444 to be in Colonial, $19,790 to be in Cap and Gown, $20,400 to be in Tower and $20,760 to be in Ivy.
All juniors and seniors who are on financial aid automatically get about $2,000 more aid than a sophomore in their same situation would.
So for some clubs that's enough, but it depends on which club you choose. So the club that I'm in is like the second most expensive on the street, unfortunately. And so because of that, it's not actually within the financial aid boundary. And so I do have out-of-pocket costs.
Sophomore dues, as it's well known, are not covered by financial aid. So while quad is the cheapest option even for sophomore dues, it is hindering my ability to do other things, like buy a plane ticket to go home to see my family.
I like constantly feel selfish because of it, just because looking back on my decision, like knowing I could have gone independent and gotten so much more money in financial aid, like literally thousands of dollars more in financial aid, but I decided to spend that on an expensive eating club instead. It's just difficult to, you know, manage that scene.
It kind of like makes it seem like you're paying just to have a social life, like you're paying to hang out and have food. So for me, it didn't really make a lot of sense to join an eating club and sort of just like figure out whether or not I want to be an independent student or just be on the meal plan.
It's sad though, because if you don't do it, then like you feel like you're missing out on this really integral part of the Princeton experience. So I think that's what pressures a lot of people to do it as well, even if it does put a financial strain on your family and yourself.
We're definitely doing better than we would have 10 years ago and then some other universities are currently. But at the same time, there's a long ways to go, I think.
How do we ensure that we're not just saying to our FLY students or to any of our students, okay, you need to come here and you need to kind of just assimilate to everything that Princeton has? That's not the goal, right? The goal is really to kind of think about how do we remake Princeton in a way that will meet the needs of all of our students who are here, that will allow all of our students to kind of thrive here, and how do we allow them to become leaders on our campus that will help transform the institution, right? To really remake it in the image of who our student body is.
About her work in Hollywood and her transition from study.
Sorry, he was laughing.
Oh, Sam, not me.
Seb!
He was playing in the mouse!
Now. I wish we had my Seb again, though. What are you doing?
I'm elaborate.
Well, I think that we can all agree that we've learned a lot tonight on the show. Seb, what did we learn?
We learned to trust each other in the worst of times.
That's very true. That's very true.
And we learned how to put on fake mustaches.
I'm afraid that's all we got time for. Thank you so, so much for watching.
Yay!
Yay!
It's Princeton Tonight!
Good night. And may God have mercy on your souls.
We did it, okay?
Blair Witch Project right now.
That's all we've got time for tonight, children. Thank you for watching.
You didn't even flinch.